Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Show Won't Go On, the most shocking, bizarre, and historic deaths of performers on stage, by Jeff Abraham and Burt Kearns. Read by Michael Butler Murray. Prologue. This project began with an Elvis Presley tribute concert in 2004. Elvis's announcer, Al Devoren, the man who'd say, "Elvis has left the building," at the end of shows back when Elvis was alive, spoke the phrase into a microphone after the performance by Elvis impersonator Paul Casey. Al got a standing ovation, then signed autographs in the lobby. One of us was there at the Trump 29 Casino in Coachella, California that night when some fans suggested to Al that he write his autobiography. "I know, I keep putting it off," Al replied. "But I will one day. I have time." He set off for home in Las Vegas the next morning, only to be killed in a car crash in the desert. This unfortunate Elvis-related event led to a discussion that turned into an exploration that was even more ambitious and unwieldy than the one you're about to hear. It was a study of performers who died after a show. These were the show people who took their bows, wiped off their grease paint, put on their top hats, and made it to the car or plane or back to the hotel room, and then, like poor Al Devoren, wound up leaving the building. Next came an accounting of the troopers who didn't quite make it to the stage or set, because death stuck out its bony foot and tripped them up along the way. That exploration became an investigation that landed on an even more surprising and devastating show business phenomenon that has gone, for the most part, unexamined until now. The ones who died on stage while performing. The investigation took us to Broadway shows, nightclubs, dinner theaters, amphitheaters, playhouses, arenas, concert halls, auditoriums, studios, tents, movie sets, and televised events, and introduced us to an illustrious group that includes actors, singers, musicians, magicians, comedians, DJs, chorus girls, models, journeymen, and social media stars, people who are remembered as much for the way they left the building as for what they did inside. We didn't include athletes, fighters, toreadors, race car drivers, or others who entered the field, arena, or ring, accepting that death is always a potential outcome. Initially, we chronicled every recorded death of a performer on stage. Our research led to hundreds of incidents dating back centuries, and a project that turned out to be more comprehensive than any study previously attempted. Urban legends were debunked, long-held assumptions contradicted, Wikipedia-style misinformation corrected, new details from well-known stories unearthed, and the obscure stood, or were laid, shoulder to shoulder with the legendary. As the work continued and the pages flew from the calendar, however, we discovered phenomenon just as compelling and even more frustrating. Performers keep dying on stage. Every month or so, a singer would collapse mid-song, an act of violence would shatter the tranquility of a recital, or one of the new breed of social media personalities would expire live on camera before millions of fans. The number of performers who die on stage is always growing, too many and too often to be contained within the pages of a single volume. So we boiled it down to the onstage deaths that really stood out among the rest. These are performers who died in front of an audience, grouped roughly into the categories of their specialties, with nods to additional related onstage passings that bring the total well into the three-figure range. These are our picks. One can always debate if others deserve equal attention. To die on stage. Is it a curse? Could it be a gift? Is there any consolation in knowing that these performers died doing what they loved? And was it really the way they'd have wanted to go? Some answers, and much more, will be found in the following. 1. The Guinness World Record. Jane Little. Jane Little stood 4 feet 11 inches tall and weighed less than 100 pounds. Yet she played the double bass, the largest instrument in the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra, and one that stood a good foot taller than she did. She was Jane Finley, and 16 years old when she joined the Atlanta Youth Symphony Orchestra in 1945. She made her debut that February 4th, wearing a pastel evening gown, and she remained with the group when it began to admit adults and grew into the Atlanta Symphony. Jane married the symphony's principal flutist in 1953. Warren Little was 6'2" and would carry his little flute and her big bass. Even after he retired, he'd drive her to and from Atlanta Symphony Hall in their big baby blue Chevrolet Caprice Classic station wagon. During her career, Jane played for conductors such as Igor Stravinsky, Leopold Stokowski, Aaron Copland, and James Levine. In 1996, she performed at the opening and closing ceremonies of the Atlanta Summer Olympics with conductor John Williams. The highlight of her symphonic career came on February 4th, 2016, 2 days after she celebrated her 87th birthday. Jane wasn't in the best of health that day. She had been undergoing chemotherapy treatment for multiple myeloma and had suffered a cracked vertebra the previous August. But after months of rehabilitation, she was ready to play the double bass once more. The Washington Post reported on the occasion. On Monday, Jane Little got her weekly chemo shot. Thursday, she gulped down 5 green steroid pills and reported to Symphony Hall to fight her way back to the stage. And that she did, all 98 pounds of her, stroking a D chord at 8:04 p.m. to make her comeback official. With that stroke of the bow, Jane Little became holder of the Guinness World Record as the musician with the longest tenure with an orchestra. With 71 years, she passed the record set by Francis Darger, the violinist who'd retired in 2012 after 70 years with the Utah Symphony. Indeed, the prospect of taking the title was one more reason Jane decided to return to the symphony for one last season, despite serious illness and injuries. "I'd thumb through the Guinness book and say, wouldn't it be neat?" she told the Post. "A lot of people do crazy things like sitting on a flagpole for 3 days. I just kept on. It was just me and the lady in Utah. So finally I said, I'm going to do this." To Michael Kurth, who joined the bass section in 1994, Jane's accomplishment was less inspirational than mythical. Kurth tells us, "You'd have to be really ambitious to be inspired, because it was such an unattainable record. To spend that many years on the job, it's almost inconceivable. She was certainly a great musician. Nobody can stand in that job for long unless they have real intuitive and innate musicality. And her technique was amazing. Her hands were so flexible. I would sit behind her and her thumb would bend in angles that I didn't think human thumbs could bend." Jane and her double bass were on stage on the afternoon of Sunday, May 15th, 2016, for an Atlanta Symphony Pops concert. Broadway's Golden Age was a great, rousing show. For an encore, the program called for a tune from Irving Berlin's classic musical, Annie Get Your Gun. The players were about 30 seconds from the final measures of the encore number when Jane stopped playing. Michael Kurth was playing bass right beside her, sharing her music stand. "There were maybe 10 measures left in the last piece of the last program of the year," he says, "and I suddenly saw, out of the corner of my eye, her falling. Her bass teetered over and crashed into my bass. There's still a gouge in my bass from it. And she just collapsed over, unresponsive." Kurth and tuba player Michael Moore, a mere 49-year veteran of the orchestra, carried the tiny double bassist off the stage while the rest of the orchestra went on with the show and completed the number. A physician who was a member of the orchestra and a nurse from the audience worked to revive her, but Jane Little never regained consciousness. After the paramedics took Jane away, Michael Kurth joined most of the orchestra backstage behind the bass section. There were tears and hugs. "We weren't calculating and assessing the momentousness of the occasion. We were just reacting and trying to... I mean, it's our Jane. We all loved Jane," he says. That night, Kurth told the Washington Post, "She seemed to be made of bass resin and barbed wire. She was unstoppable. I honestly thought I was going to retire before she did." the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra announced on Facebook that it would dedicate the following weekend's performances to the late Jane Little. One commenter on the site said she was still shaken after witnessing her collapse, but added, "R.I.P., dear lady, you are an inspiration." Another called the final concert at Atlanta Symphony Hall harrowing, but added that Jane Little died doing what she loved. "What an amazing way to go," orchestra fan Amanda Turner wrote. Senior orchestra manager Russell Williamson marveled at the timing. For her to go out at the end of the concert, the golden age of Broadway, and it was during the encore, he told the Post. Michael Kurth points out that when she played her last note, she was doing what she loved, surrounded by people she loved, in a place that was like home to her. "It was a pretty spectacular exit, frankly," he says, "for a really spectacular lady. I mean, you really couldn't write a better Hollywood ending." Had the actual ending been scripted by a Hollywood screenwriter, reviewers would say it was too obvious. The song that Jane Little was performing when she collapsed to the stage was "There's No Business Like Show Business." 2. Theater. Corpsing is British theatrical slang for unintentionally breaking character by laughing. The origin of the term has never been nailed down, but it most likely arose from a laughing fit by an actor portraying a corpse. Another, far more literal interpretation of corpsing would be to actually become a corpse on stage, by dying. This has happened many times in many venues over the years. If there's a stage on which to act, there's a public platform on which to drop dead. Some onstage deaths are more obvious than others. The 17th century French actor and playwright, Jean-Baptiste Poquelin, known to the world as Molière, was 51 and suffering from tuberculosis on February 17, 1673, when he performed in the title role in his play, Le Malade Imaginaire, The Hypochondriac, for King Louis XIV at the Théâtre du Palais Royal in Paris. Already so ill that he was forced to perform while sitting in a red velvet chair, he was seized by a violent coughing fit and began hemorrhaging from the mouth. "Don't be alarmed, I'm not dead," Molière announced, insisting on going on with the show before he collapsed after an even more copious hemorrhage. They carried him off stage in his red velvet chair. No hypochondriac, he was indeed dead within a few hours. Then there was Emil Haste, the comedic actor who in 1904 starred in a Berlin touring company production of Ludwig Fulda's play The Twin Sister. When the show opened at the Municipal Theater in Niemczech, Poland, on March 24th, he had the crowd roaring with laughter through the first act and received half a dozen curtain calls. On the sixth, he drew a revolver from his hip pocket, placed it to his temple, and in front of the entire audience pulled the trigger and blew out his brains. One wire service reported that, when the blood was seen to flow, women fainted and men fought their way to the stage to get a glimpse at the suicide. Apparently, one of the actresses had rejected his proposal of marriage. If Haste's suicide seems an overreaction, consider Ludwig Heinle. On October 26, 1926, the actor ran on stage and stabbed himself to death with a dagger during a performance of Peer Gynt at the Municipal Theater in Strasbourg, France. He was upset that the stage manager gave him a hard time for showing up late. Despite such histrionics, the most memorable deaths on stage are ones in which an actor recites a line and then takes his or her leave from the stage in mortal coil, as if on cue. The exit line often serves as an all-too-perfect setup for the ultimate punchline. Most of the time, the audience thinks it's part of the show. Joe Greenwald. After 3 weeks of rehearsals in Los Angeles, Homer Curran's road production of Golden Boy rolled north in March 1938 for two tryout performances at the Libero Theater in Santa Barbara. The show, starring Francis Lederer, would be a hot ticket. Clifford Odets's acclaimed play about violinist-turned-prizefighter Joe Bonaparte was a smash hit on Broadway and still running at the Belasco Theater on West 44th Street. where it had opened the previous November with Luther Adler in the title role and Francis Farmer as his love interest. The only omen of any potential problems was that the first road performance was scheduled for April Fool's Day. 21-year-old future movie star Glenn Ford had the job as stage manager, and two lines in the third act, Knockout and Lombardo Stiff. Actors are a very superstitious breed, he told his son Peter, as noted in the latter's biography, Glenn Ford a Life. So there was already some feeling of uneasiness among some in the cast. The curtain went up and everything went smoothly, until we got to the second scene. In the second scene of the first act, Joe's father, Mr. Bonaparte, shows off the expensive violin he plans to give his son the next day for his 21st birthday. The actor playing the boxer's immigrant father in the play, Joe Greenwald, said his line, "A good life is possible," and suddenly collapsed dead of a heart attack, Ford remembered. "I rushed onto the stage immediately. He was lying in the arms of one of the other actors." The trade journal Variety reported a different line in the Golden Boy script as the 60-year-old actor's final words. He had just concluded his line, "This is the moment for which I have waited," when he collapsed. The New York Times offered its own version. "Mr. Greenwald had just uttered the opening lines of a speech, All My Life, when he crumpled to the floor." So there's some confusion. A good life, possible. This is the moment for which I have waited. All my life. Any of those reported last words would suffice, as Joseph Greenwald's body lay motionless and Sam White, the only other actor on the stage at the time, called frantically for the curtain. The curtain was dropped, the capacity audience was eventually dismissed, and everyone got refunds. The Santa Barbara Fire Department's pull motor squad tried to revive Greenwald, to no avail. He was already dead, Glenn Ford said. God, what an experience. There was no understudy for Joe Greenwald, so the show was shut down for a week until a replacement was found. The producers brought in Lee J. Cobb from the original Broadway production. Edith Webster. Edith Webster died on stage every night. For 8 years, she'd played the role of the grandmother in community theater productions of The Drunkard at the Moose Lodge Inn in Towson, Maryland. In each performance, the role called for her character to sing a song, then collapse to the floor dead. That's what she did on Saturday night, November 22nd, 1986. There was tremendous applause. Hearing that, she died, the director Richard Byrd told United Press International. The applause was the last thing Edith Webster would ever hear. When the other actors called for a doctor and phoned paramedics, most of the 200 people in the audience thought Edith's exit was part of the show. When the performance was stopped and they realized Edith had died of a heart attack, most of the audience sat quietly for almost an hour. Some of them prayed. Edith Webster was 60. Her daughter, Mary Todd Webster, told the UPI reporter that the way she went was not a bad thing. A lot of people have been saying it. Night after night she died and she died, director Byrd observed. And last night she died and she really did. By the way, what was the name of Edith's show-stopping song? Please don't talk about me when I'm gone. Kent Stork. Kent Stork was a community theater actor whose death was notable not only for his dedication as an amateur thespian, but also for the name of the last play in which he starred. Kent was already well known to a certain audience long before he stepped onto a stage. For 39 years, he and his wife Joyce ran a flower shop in Fremont, Nebraska, and over time became leading experts on the African violet. Kent won a dozen major awards at national flower shows. He and Joyce traveled as far away as Russia and Hong Kong to speak to growers. They wrote a column for African Violet magazine that was turned into the book, You Can Grow African Violets. One Amazon.com reviewer called the book, My AV Bible. After Kent and Joyce hit 65, they decided to retire. They closed Kent's Flowers in August 2016 and began packing for a move to Henderson, Nevada, a suburb of Las Vegas. There they'd be close to their son Zach and his family, and Kent could follow his passion. Not African violets, but show business. Kent had been bitten by the acting bug several years earlier, when he and Joyce had attended a play in Omaha, and he was invited on stage. He won his first role playing the superintendent in an Omaha Community Playhouse production of The Drowsy Chaperone. He'd appear in four more productions, including one in which he acted while inside an iron lung. It would have been January 2017 when they arrived in Henderson, Zach Stork tells us. They rolled into town at like 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock p.m., and my dad had been looking at his phone on the way in, and there was a tryout for a play that was happening that night. He'd been in the car all day, and everyone's exhausted, and he's leaving at 9 to go try out for a play somewhere. So that was definitely going to be his retirement hobby. Kent didn't get that part, but within months won a starring role at Henderson's community theater company, Theater in the Valley. The dark comedy opened on Friday night, April 21st, and was set to continue for 8 more weekend performances. On Sunday, April 30th, Kent and Joyce attended church and Bible class before Kent took the stage for the 2 p.m. matinee. Joyce was in the audience. When he first comes out on stage, it was supposed to be like he had just gotten out of a shower, Zach says. So he came out soaking wet. My mom could just tell that he seemed a little off. And she knew the script well enough that she could tell that he missed a line. He didn't look right, Joyce later told the Fremont Tribune. His coloring wasn't right. He was panting, and I kept waiting for the panting to stop, and it didn't. Then I realized he was having trouble standing. They completed part of a scene and he exited, Zach explains. The funny part, the story that I tell people, is that my mom was there, and she saw him not looking well. And then he kissed another woman, put a gun into his robe, exited the stage, and that was kind of the last she saw him fully conscious. The director came and got my mom. My dad was backstage trying to fight to the bitter end, saying that he just needed to catch his breath. Then it was like, no, we need to call 911. The show was stopped. Paramedics arrived and rushed Kent Stork to St. Rose Dominican Hospital. Zach posted on Facebook from the hospital the following day. Great and sad news from the last 24 hours. This morning, Jana and I were blessed with the birth of our beautiful daughter, Lydia, and they are both doing well. The sad part is that my dad, Kent Stork, suffered a heart attack yesterday afternoon and died in this very same hospital less than 9 hours before his granddaughter was born. Circle of life. It's kind of interesting how things line up like that, Zach says. We were preparing for my daughter to come, and then a surprise heart attack that happened less than 24 hours before. It's actually good that he was pronounced dead a little before midnight, so he and my daughter don't share the same date of departure and arrival. Kent Stork had died 2 days before his 67th birthday. Zach's mother, Joyce, a devout Lutheran, told the Tribune's Tammy Real McKeegan that she was comforted knowing that her husband was safe in the Lord's hands, and that when the last day comes, that I'll be there too, and that we'll see the Lord together. How about Zach, the eldest of Kent Stork's 2 sons? Did he take comfort knowing his father died doing what he loved? You know what? He replies. I do. Because he had gone from working 50, 60 hours a week for 4 decades and then retired. And 6 months later, he was gone. But he was able to go doing something that he was interested in. Honestly, my dad was somebody who liked attention. And the day he died, for at least a couple of hours, he was trending. When you went to the main website of the Las Vegas Review-Journal, his death story was above the story about the new Raiders stadium being built. He would have been kind of tickled to know that his passing garnered such attention. There was another reason that Kent Stork's death got attention. The name of the play was Art of Murder. Zach is able to laugh about that. When the newspaper posted the link to the article to Facebook, I couldn't help but read through some of the comments, he says. Some were like, Sounds like a bad episode of Murder, She Wrote. That's kind of funny. He continues, when he was brought to the hospital, he had this stage gun in his pocket. I think the hospitals here are used to having real guns come into the emergency room, and my mom actually got a call late that night from the coroner's office to see if she thought this was a suspicious death that needed to be investigated. No, not because of the name of the play. I think it was just because of the odd circumstances. Where he died while performing. David Burns. Broadway star David Burns was singing, dancing, and acting his heart out on Friday, March 12, 1971. He was on stage at the Forest Theater in Philadelphia in an out-of-town tryout for John Kander and Fred Ebb's latest musical, 70 Girls 70. Kander and Ebb had written the songs for Cabaret. They'd go on to musicals like Chicago and Fosse, and write New York, New York, the Liza Minnelli showstopper that became Frank Sinatra's anthem. But this show was a bit more risky in concept. The plot concerned the residents of a retirement hotel, and 70 was the average age of the cast members. Each night, producer Arthur Whitelaw had to worry about whether the entire cast would survive to make it to Broadway. In fact, Burns, best known for his long-running role as Horace Vandergelder in Hello, Dolly, had signed on to play Harry the desk clerk only weeks earlier. He was 68 and had replaced Eddie Foy Jr., who couldn't remember his lines at 66. On stage on this night, everyone was doing just fine. The show was getting laughs and the musical numbers were boffo. Then, around 10 p.m., near the end of the second act, David Burns literally sang and danced and acted his heart out. In the middle of the number, he exclaimed, "How about this move?" He did a double take and spun around. The audience roared with laughter. Burns then clutched his chest and fell to the stage. It was a heart attack. During the confusion that followed, Burns' understudy, Coley Worth, helped drag his body off stage. Backstage, Worth tried to revive him. To no avail. David Burns was dead. Producer Arthur Whitelaw did his best to put a positive spin, no pun intended, on the death of his star. "He went, I guess, the way he would have liked to have gone. He died the way he lived. He died after one of the biggest laughs of the evening." Whitelaw later told Coley Worth to prepare to take over the role of Harry the desk clerk for the Saturday matinee. Worth's life had led to this moment. He was born Coleman Rothman, 62 years earlier, and first took the stage as a kid, performing in his father's minstrel show before running away to join a vaudeville circuit. He made his Broadway debut in 1927 in a show called A La Carte, and in the decades since, had been in countless productions. He'd understudied for David Burns, and a funny thing happened on the way to the Forum and Hello, Dolly, but had never been given a chance like this. He managed 5 hours of sleep that night and was back on the Forest Theater stage at 9 a.m. Saturday morning, rehearsing for the 2 p.m. show. He went over the book piece by piece. This early in the process, there were many scenes he hadn't yet studied. He knew he'd have to wing it and do the best he could. That's what Coley Worth did. He learned what he could, and when he hit the stage for the show, he let instinct handle the rest. When he missed a cue or flubbed a line, he improvised. He invented. He ad-libbed. The audience was never the wiser. Arthur Whitelaw and the other backers stood at the back of the house and knew they were witnessing something very special. After the show, Whitelaw came backstage and embraced the actor. "Well, we got through it," Worth said. "It was fine, fine," Whitelaw assured him. "You did a wonderful job." Teary-eyed co-stars congratulated him, whispered a bravo, and patted him on the back. Someone asked Coley Worth if he thought he'd wind up taking over the leading role on Broadway. Coley smiled wistfully, sadly, knowingly. "They'll probably bring in a star," he said. He was correct. After the evening performance, Arthur Whitelaw closed the show and announced that the play was heading back to rehearsals in New York. When 70s Girls 70 opened at the Broadhurst Theater on April 15, 1971, Hans Conried was starring in David Burns' role. The show ran for 9 previews and 35 performances before it closed. a month later. Coley Worth lived to 79. He died of pneumonia in Port St. Lucie, Florida. In a remembrance of David Burns printed in the New York Times 2 weeks after his death, Hello Dolly star Carol Channing recalled their reaction to President John F. Kennedy's assassination. The evening's performance had been canceled due to the tragedy, and while I cried, Davy handed me Kleenex and fed me lines. We decided then and there that the lucky ones died with their boots on. The only way to go, we agreed, was in the line of duty. I cannot think of any way that Davy would rather go. Interlude. Bad Night for Green Day. Pedro Aunion Monroy. With his performance company, in fact Aerial Dance, Pedro Aunion Monroy was at the cutting edge of theatrical presentations, combining acting, dancing, acrobatics, harnesses, and bungee cords to create a new kind of entertainment. Aerial dance theater is a language that brings a unique tempo to a performance as a result of constantly shifting perspectives and dramatic movement, he explained on the company's website. The audience is drawn into the performance through its captivating sense of wonder and risk. In fact, had presented many productions around the world since it was established in 2001 in Brixton, the rough and diverse neighborhood in South London, where Pedro had settled. The company also operated, under the name of Chatahecho, which translates to in fact, in Madrid, Spain, where Pedro was born, and was still a popular figure on the cultural scene. Pedro had studied at Madrid's Royal Conservatory of Dance, and since the late 1990s had acted and done stunt work in films, including Cyrano de Bergerac, starring Plácido Domingo, and was a senior choreographer for the 2008 Spanish television reality show Circus. In 2017, he was 42, athletic and handsome, with a trim beard, and he lived outside London, in the seaside resort of Brighton. He had a good life there, making ends meet as a massage therapist at the posh Grand Hotel, and had a British boyfriend named Michael Sells. Pedro was popular among the Brits, who got a kick out of his accent. Some even called him Peter. Pedro performed across Europe with In Fact and conducted workshops for aspiring aerial dancers. He was invited to return to his hometown in July to perform at a major festival, Mad Cool, Spain's answer to the Coachella Valley Music and Arts Festival in Southern California. Like Coachella, Mad Cool's inaugural lineup in 2016 had featured a mix of artists and genres. Classic rock stars The Who and Neil Young, alternative favorites Jane's Addiction, The Prodigy, and Garbage, and contemporary acts like Flume and The Kills. The several outdoor stages also featured Spanish bands and local artists. The three-day lineup in 2017 was equally impressive. The first day was to be headlined by the Foo Fighters, the last by Kings of Leon. On the middle day, Friday, July 7th, the main act was Green Day, the punk rock band turned Broadway musical stars. After a day of music that included sets by Spoon, Rancid, Ryan Adams, and many others, Pedro had a premiere spot on the main stage, following the British rockers Alt-J and immediately before the entrance of Green Day. Of course, Pedro would actually be performing above the stage. He'd dance in the sky in an illuminated cage as it was hoisted 100 feet in the air by a crane. His image would be projected on the big screen on stage so everyone in the audience could get a close look. On Thursday, the day the festival opened with the Foo Fighters, Pedro logged onto Facebook and tagged Michael Sells on a treated photo of the couple together. He wrote, "I can't wait to see my beautiful boyfriend. Love, come to my arms." It would be his last Facebook post. By the time Alt-J left the stage just before 11 p.m. on Friday night, there were more than 35,000 people waiting for Green Day. The stage went dark, and the opening chords of Prince's Purple Rain rang from the sound system. This was Pedro's moment, a tribute to the rock idol and musical genius who'd died unexpectedly and tragically in April 2016. All eyes were on Pedro inside the white box, with clear sidewalls but without a floor as it rose from the stage. Prince's voice rang from the loudspeakers. Heads craned to see Pedro moving gracefully as he danced and spun in 360-degree turns. Others watched his breathtaking movements on the big screen. Many held up cell phones to record the image of the figure inside the illuminated cube. Though he was suspended by various straps and harnesses, he seemed to be floating in midair. Pedro was lifted 100 feet into the air. The crowd sang along with the recording of Prince. Purple rain, I only wanted to see you bathing in the purple rain. I never wanted to be your weekend lover. At that moment, Pedro dropped like a stone. His harness had snapped. The figure inside the cube was now a man, plummeting 100 feet to the hard earth. Thousands of people, the ones looking up at the box, saw him fall with their own eyes, feet first, and extending his arms at the last second, as if to prepare for a landing on his feet. Others watched the shocking image flash by on the big screen, when, even more vividly, Pedro plunged toward and past the camera trained on him from below. Still others would, moments later, watch again what they thought they'd seen while recording cell phone videos. Many people screamed. Others cried or were sickened. Among those in the crowd was Michael Sells, watching his partner perform for the very first time. The big screen showed images of the aftermath at the side of the stage, including the paramedics gathered around the broken aerial dancer. Anyone who'd assumed the fall had been part of the show, or that a dummy had been dropped, could see that wasn't the case. The medical team went through all the motions of trying to save a life for half an hour before giving up. Pedro Aunion Monroy was dead. Meanwhile, as thousands of fans waited in the humid field, festival organizers debated what to do. There was no announcement, but a decision was made. At least for security reasons to prevent any panic or disruption, the show would go on. Green Day took the stage about 45 minutes late and performed their show, the last of their European tour. There was no mention of Pedro. A sense of disgust rippled through the audience. Even before their final encores, social media was already aflame with outrage that these American idiots would perform as usual after their opening act had died on stage. Shortly after the show, the band tweeted, "We just got off stage at Mad Cool Festival to disturbing news. A very brave artist named Pedro lost his life tonight in a tragic accident. Our thoughts and prayers go out to his family and friends." Many people reacted angrily. One post included the accusation, "You lie!" The next day, the Green Day organization issued a long statement in the name of the band's 45-year-old frontman, Billy Joe Armstrong. The statement claimed that members of Green Day were in an artist's backstage compound, a half mile away from the stage when the tragedy occurred. Armstrong wrote that the band was warming up and ready to hit the stage at 11:25 p.m. But 15 minutes before showtime was told by local authorities to wait to go on stage because there was some sort of security issue. We had no clue there was any such accident. The band took the stage around midnight, played 2.5 hours, and he wrote, "Everything seemed normal." It was only after the show, he insisted, that the band was informed of what happened to Pedro. All of us were in disbelief. I don't know why the authorities chose not to tell us about the accident before our concert. If we had known prior to our performance, we most likely would not have played at all. We are not heartless people. The safety and well-being at any of our concerts absolutely comes first. What happened to Pedro is unthinkable. Once again, we are heartbroken for his friends and family. We are also shocked and heartbroken for anyone that had to witness this tragedy. Pedro's sister announced his death on Facebook. Estefi Chahe wrote that she and her family were devastated. The post also included this line, "Estaba haciendo lo que más le gustaba, un espectáculo en el Mad Cool." He was doing what he loved, performing in Mad Cool. 3. Comedy. Comedians die on stage every night. Not literally, but if you ask one of them, he or she would probably say that a real death is preferable to the figurative kind. When the audience is an oil painting, and the clinking of glasses, coughing, and the plinking drips of flop sweat are all that can be heard amid the dead silence of a failing routine. But an actual death on stage, a real live heart-stopping death amid the hilarity, is something else altogether. And it often takes the audience a few minutes to get the joke, the big cosmic joke, that is. There are a few onstage comedy deaths that have made their marks in show business history. Harry Einstein, a.k.a. Park Your Carcass. One of the comedy death stories most told is that of dialect comedian Harry Einstein, known for his pseudo-Greek character, Nick Park Your Carcass. As in, park your carcass, sit down. Parky, as he was called by fans and friends alike, was the father of future comedians Bob Einstein and Albert Brooks. Nay, Albert Einstein. Not necessary to explain why he changed his name to Brooks. In the 1930s and 40s, he appeared in films and on the Eddie Cantor and Al Jolson radio shows. For 3 seasons, he had his own radio program, Meet Me at Parky's, in which Park Your Carcass was running a lunch counter. In 1958, at 54, Harry Parky Einstein was in poor health and with heart and back problems, living off investments and, with the exception of a role on the television anthology series, Playhouse 90, limiting his appearances to dinners and roasts hosted by the Friars Club, the private show business club whose membership boasted top comedians and entertainers of the day. A gala Friars Club event took place on Sunday night, November 23rd. 1,200 people packed into the International Ballroom of the Beverly Hilton Hotel, paying up to $200 a plate to attend a testimonial dinner honoring Hollywood comedy power couple Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz. Art Linkletter was master of ceremonies, and the featured stars included Dean Martin, George Burns, Danny Thomas, George Murphy, Sammy Davis Jr., and Milton Berle. Parky was the only comic on the dais who didn't have a regular gig on the tube or in clubs. And, Linkletter recalled, on this particular night he was making his big comeback. When it was his turn at the podium, Parky went into a routine that poked fun at the exclusivity of the Friars Club. Audio from the big night reveals uproarious laughter from the crowd. These two people we are honoring tonight, Danny Arnaz and Lucille Bowles, have met every requirement of our screening committee, but you must not think that the Friars Club is an easy club to get into. Quite to the contrary, it is most difficult. Before a prospective candidate is even issued an application, he must first satisfy us, beyond any question of a doubt, that he is either a resident, that gets the laughs rolling, or a non-resident of the state of California. A huge wave of laughter shakes the room. He then must be proposed by and then vouched for by at least 2 men, who are listed in the phone book. A torrent of laughter. The Friars Club membership, he says, includes many prominent businessmen, several fine judges, and quite a few defendants. Years later, Linkletter, Burl, and Friars Entertainment chairman Barry Merkin relived the evening for the Friars tribute documentary, Let Me In, I Hear Laughter. He was, Art Linkletter recalled, up there knocking them dead. It was the most hilarious routine I have ever stolen, ever heard, said Burl, and he actually was the hit of the show. He did a monologue that lasted 10 minutes that under normal circumstances might have lasted 6 minutes. Merkin, who'd opened the show with the Friars song, Here's to the Friars, remembered. But the laughs were so great, so impossible to believe, that as a result it just stretched. He got a standing ovation, Burl recalled. While he was standing up and bowing, he said, thank you, and they were cheering. As Parky made his way back to his seat, Linkletter asked the room, how come anyone as funny as that isn't on the air? Parky settled back next to Burl and said, yeah, how come? and then suddenly he put his head over on Milton Berle's lap and shut his eyes, and apparently slumped down, Linkletter said. And everybody stopped laughing and applauding because he had apparently fainted. Or worse. Parkey's wife, the actress Thelma Leeds, was sitting in the audience with Ed Wynn to her right. Moments earlier, she'd bragged to him that Parkey wrote all his own material. Now, while all around her looked confused, she knew immediately what was wrong with her husband. She bolted onto the dais and reached into his pocket for the pill box. She opened it and plucked out a nitroglycerin tablet that would increase blood flow through his coronary arteries. But when she tried to put the pill in his mouth and under his tongue, she couldn't. His teeth were clenched tight. Meanwhile, Wynn was shouting advice in his giggly voice. Put his head down! Put his head down! Burle screamed shrilly. Is there a doctor in the house? Audience members, caught up in the excitement, called by name the doctors they knew would be in the room. Friars' roasts and banquets are traditionally benefits for hospitals. This one benefited a Burmese leper colony. So there was no shortage. 5 top specialists jumped from their seats. Linkletter recalled, I said, ladies and gentlemen, we have a little medical accident here for the moment. We wonder if anyone happens to have any nitroglycerin nitro tablets. Well, the surprise of my life. Big producers, writers, stars came forward with vials. Apparently half the people in the room had heart problems. Everybody was frozen in the room, Merkin added. The drama is unbelievable because they knew what was happening. And I tried to get Lucy to unleash her fingers from the table to come back. And I couldn't get her. I couldn't move her hands. Amid the ruckus, Burl waved to singer Tony Martin. Get up, stall, do something to get their mind off it. Do something, sing a song. He says, all right. Tony Martin quickly, it wasn't his fault, improv, ad lib. He got up and sang, There's No Tomorrow. Said Linkletter, there was probably a couple of sympathetic heart attacks when There's No Tomorrow rang out. Burl, George Burns, and others carried Parkey's carcass backstage. Within seconds, one of the doctors had sterilized a pocket knife, sliced open Parkey's chest, and was holding his heart in his hand, massaging it. Another doctor yanked the cord from an electric lamp and placed the live ends against the heart muscle, like a MacGyver defibrillator, shocking it into beating again. One of the doctors said that Parkey had probably died on the dais, but the hand massage brought him back to life. The 5 doctors took turns massaging and got a faint beat going from the right side of the heart. The left side only fluttered. Firemen and police arrived with plasma and a pulmotor, a device to inflate the lungs and possibly get him breathing again. As they worked behind the curtain, the show went on. For a while. The Associated Press reported that the off-key singing of George Burns and the audience's laughter could be heard over the pulsations of the pulmotor. There were several announcements that Parkey would be fine, but everyone on the dais knew better. When it was his turn to address the crowd, Desi Arnaz was ashen-faced and barely audible. This is one of the moments that Lucy and I have waited a lifetime for, but it's meaningless. They say the show must go on, but why must it? Let's close the show now by praying for this wonderful man backstage who made a world laugh. He took the award that Linkletter had presented him and crammed it in his pocket. Lucy stepped to the microphone and through her tears said, I can say nothing. As the proceedings were wrapped, they cued Sammy Davis Jr. for one last number. He decided not to perform. And then everyone just sat there, Merkin said. A few people left, but there were 1,000 people in the room. Everybody wanted to know what the outcome was. Parkey's wife went up to the dais, and she sat at the very end. And when she saw the 5 doctors leave with their sleeves rolled up, very glum, she knew. And, oh God, she let out a screech. Dr. Alfred Goldman of City of Hope Hospital pronounced Parkeycarcus dead at 1:10 a.m., about 8 minutes after he was stricken. When it was over, Ed Wynn spoke to a reporter. This is ample proof that the old saying the show must go on is a lot of baloney, he said. The show doesn't have to go on, and it does not, as you saw tonight. Al Kelly, It turns out that Harry Parkyocarcus Einstein wasn't the only funny-talking comedian to die at a Friars Club function after slaying the crowd. Time has forgotten Al Kelly. The man born Abraham Kalish was a vaudeville.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.